A very good morning, children. Welcome back to another interesting session of organic chemistry. In the previous session, our presenter Sridevi madam, principal TSMS Kudur, has introduced you about phenols and ethers. In today's session, madam will be discussing about properties of phenols and ethers. Welcome, madam.
Good morning, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you so much.
Please take over the session.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am. Good morning, dear students. Once again, a happy welcome to the chemistry webinar. See, I'm here to take you into the world of organic chemistry again, the chemistry of carbon and its compounds. So in our previous sessions, we have discussed about alkyl halides, alcohols, and we started phenols, isn't it? See, in my previous class, I have explained you the nomenclature of phenols and then about the preparations of phenols. So today, we are going to deal about the properties of phenols. Okay, see, let me start the session right now. Okay, so once again, a happy morning to all of you children. So it's my privilege to be here as a part of this webinar team, and also I'm honored to be a chemistry teacher, right? So let me directly take you into the chemical properties of phenols. Okay, so then, see, what are phenols? C6H5OH. See, when the OH group is directly attached to the benzene nucleus, so they are called as phenols, isn't it? So let us see the chemical properties of phenols. So phenols are acidic in nature, isn't it? So they react with active metals like sodium and liberate hydrogen, so which tells us they are acidic in nature. So today we are going to learn about the chemical properties of phenols. Okay, so in my previous lesson, I have explained you the strength of acidic nature of phenol when compared with alcohol. See, what is the reason? So the reason is they are stabilized by resonance. So what is resonance? The phenomenon of writing two or more structures for a single compound, but none of the structures individually can explain its entire properties. It's called as resonance. So let me start the first property of this, and then so the first property is esterification. See, I'm dealing this property as a separate one. Okay, so what is esterification? When an alcohol reacts with a carboxylic acid, it forms an ester. What does it forms? Ester. And that is called as esterification. What is it? Esterification. See, now let us see the esterification of these phenols. So phenols reacts with, okay, so carboxylic acids and their derivatives also. So we will see all these reactions now. So this is our phenol, and which is reacting with carboxylic acid. What is the carboxylic acid here I'm using? It is acetic acid. See what happens? See, this H2O will be eliminated, and what do you get? You will get an ester. Okay, so what do you get? You will get OCOCH3, okay, plus H2O. So what is this? So this is phenyl acetate or acetophenone. Okay, so now when phenols reacts with carboxylic acids and their derivatives, so what does it form? It forms an ester. It forms an ester, and this reaction is called as esterification. What is it? Esterification. See, what is an ester? The RC double bond OOR is an ester. Okay, so here it is forming an ester, right? So this is called as esterification. And let us see the other one also. The phenol, when reacts with the derivatives of carboxylic acid, what are the derivatives of carboxylic acids? See, the derivatives of carboxylic acids are acid chlorides, that is acetyl chloride and acetic anhydride. When it reacts with these compounds, it also forms esters. This HCl is eliminated. Okay, so again, what do you get? So you will get an ester. what is ester which we are going to get here. So we are going to get once again our phenyl acetate, right? That is acetophenone. Okay, OCOCH3 plus HCl. Here HCl is eliminated. See, now let us write the names of these compounds. So this is nothing but our phenol, and then it is reacting with the acetyl chloride, right? Acetyl chloride. Okay, and ethanoyl chloride. What is the IUPAC name? Ethanoyl. Why ethanoyl? Because it contains two carbons. So ethanoyl chloride, and reacts with this phenol and forms this acetophenone, that is phenyl acetate, which is an ester, right? And then this reaction is called as, all these esterification reactions are called as Scharton-Bowman reaction. What is it? Scharton-Bowman reaction. So please remember, all the name reactions are very, very important, children. So Scharton-Bowman reaction. See, I suggest you to write all the name reactions in separately in a book. And every day, you just learn them like the formulae, how you learn in mathematics. Then it will be very easy for you. So Scharton-Bowman reaction. Okay, Nana? So this is esterification. What is esterification? So when phenols reacts with carboxylic acids and their derivatives, they form esters. So, and it is called by a special name, Scharton-Bowman reaction. Okay. So then now let us move to the remaining chemical properties of these phenols, children. Right. So what are the remaining properties? See, phenols undergo electrophilic. So what is it? Electrophilic substitution reactions. Electrophilic substitution reactions, right? And then we can say that particularly aromatic. Why? Because these are aromatic alcohols, electrophilic aromatic substitution reactions. Now let us see all this. See, what is electrophilic? An electron deficient species, an electron loving species, an electron seeking species, okay, is called as a electrophile. And then what is aromatic? Aromatic nucleus. The compounds which have benzene-like structure and obey Huckel's rule are called as aromatic hydrocarbons. What is substitution? The process of replacing an atom or a group with another atom or another group is called as substitution. See, what is it? Substitution. Okay, so then they are undergoing electrophilic aromatic substitution. Then at which position they undergo this electrophilic substitution? They undergo at ortho and para positions. So the ortho and para positions. Okay, then let us see, why does it takes place at ortho and para positions? Why? Because at these positions, it releases electrons in these positions, that is in ortho and para positions. That's why an electrophile will attack at the ortho and para positions. Okay, so this ortho and para positions are rich with electrons, hence an electron will attack at the ortho and para positions. Hence the substitution takes place at ortho and para positions. Okay, so then, and then another interesting thing here, children. So I will tell you, see, the OH group, which is already attached to the benzene nucleus, right? See, the OH group is ortho para directing group. So it is ortho para directing group. Okay, ortho para directing group. So as the electron density increases at the ortho and para positions, the electrophilic substitution takes place at these positions. Okay, right. See, now let us see all the reactions. So the first one which we are going to deal with this is the nitration reaction. Nitration. The process of substituting the nitro group is called as nitration. So phenols reacts with dilute nitric acid. Okay, so when they are heated with what is it? Dilute nitric acid. What happens? As discussed earlier, the substitution takes place at ortho and para positions. So this is the ortho and this is the para. This one is a meta. Okay. Now what compound you get? So you will get ortho nitrophenol and para nitrophenol. So this is ortho nitrophenol and this one is our para nitrophenol. So this is para nitrophenol. So hope you are able to understand this, Nana. So this is ortho nitrophenol. Okay. See, please remember your schedule was announced by the BIE, that is the Board of Intermediate Education, and in the month of March, from March 23rd, as per decided by the BIE, you will be having your examinations. So please don't neglect the classes. So please listen to the classes carefully and write down the notes. Okay, Nana. So this is para nitrophenol. Okay. So this is our phenol. So phenol on nitration gives ortho nitrophenol and para nitrophenol. And let me tell you something which is very interesting regarding these two products. So what is that? See, the thing is, this ortho nitrophenol and para nitrophenol can form hydrogen bond. What do they form? They can form hydrogen bond, and this can form an intramolecular hydrogen bonding. So here only I will write it. So intra, within itself. Okay, intra, within itself. Introspection means what? We have to inspect ourselves, isn't it? So intramolecular hydrogen bonding. And then this para nitrophenol can form intermolecular hydrogen bonding. What can it form? Intermolecular hydrogen bonding. So in between two compounds, right? Intermediate, present in between 10th class and degree, right? Like this, in between two compounds, in between paranitrophenol and another molecule of paranitrophenol. Hence, they can form intermolecular hydrogen bonding. So due to the formation of this intramolecular and intermolecular hydrogen bonding, okay, they are steam volatile, right? Steam volatile. So I will tell you what is that. So this ortho nitrophenol is steam volatile because of intramolecular hydrogen bonding. And then para nitrophenol is less steam volatile. This is a very important for your objective, Nana. Right? So less steam volatile because of intermolecular hydrogen bonding. It means it will require high temperature, isn't it? So less steam volatile means it requires more temperature because to break the intermolecular hydrogen bonding, right? And this is steam volatile because it has intramolecular hydrogen bonding. Okay, so then this is the thing about phenols. When they undergo nitration, they give ortho nitrophenol and para nitrophenol. Okay, so hope you are all comfortable, right? So now let us see what happens when this phenol is heated with concentrated nitric acid, right? Then this is also nitration, children. Now see, the previous reaction with the concentrated nitric acid is, when it is heated with concentrated nitric acid, it gives 2,4,6 trinitrophenol, which is commonly known as picric acid. What is it? So 2,4,6 trinitrophenol. Okay, so 2,4,6 trinitrophenol. The common name of this compound is picric acid. What is it? Picric acid. Okay, so picric acid. So this is the old method of preparation of picric acid, children. Now, so the recent method of preparation of picric acid is, I will tell you how it is prepared. So phenol is treated with sulfuric acid first. So it is treated with sulfuric acid, okay, H2SO4, concentrated H2SO4, and then it forms sulfonic acid. What does it forms? Sulfonic acid. So that is the sulfonic group is substituted at the ortho and para positions like this. And then now again it is treated with the concentrated nitric acid here. Remember, so concentrated nitric acid. And now you will get a picric acid. That is 2,4,6 trinitrophenol. So this is the recent method of preparation of picric acid. Okay. So again the same compound. What is it? Picric acid. 2,4,6 trinitrophenol. So hope you have understood this. So this is a picric acid, formation of picric acid. I have shown you both the methods of preparation, right? So now let us move to the halogenation. What is it? Halogenation. So that is here we are taking the bromine. That is a bromination. What is it? Halogenation. So halogens are 7A group elements, fluorine, chlorine, bromine, iodine, and astatine belongs to the 7th group of the periodic table, and they are called as halogens, salt forming elements. Okay, halus means salt, genus means forming, so salt forming elements. Okay, so then coming to the halogenation, and then I told you earlier that now we are going to deal with the bromination, isn't it? So now let us see the reaction. Okay, phenol when treated with, okay, bromine, right? Bromine, okay. And then what does it give? It will give ortho and para-bromophenol. Ortho-bromophenol and para-bromophenol. Now, this is bromine in the presence of carbon disulfide at 0 degree centigrade. Now, what do you get? You'll get ortho-bromophenol and para-bromophenol. Ortho-bromophenol and para-bromophenol. So, as discussed earlier, the substitution takes place at ortho and para positions. So, this is a phenol and this is ortho-bromophenol. Okay. And then this is para-bromophenol. Okay. Para-bromophenol. Right. Okay. So, now let us see the reaction. See what happens when this phenol is treated with bromine water. Let us see. Phenol, when treated with bromine water. Okay. So, bromine water. What happens is, see the temperature is 0 to 5 degrees centigrade. You will get a white precipitate of 2,4,6 tribromophenol. Okay. Right. So 2,4,6 tribromophenol. See, I know that organic chemistry is a bit tough for a few people, and those people who will feel that it is very easy, then it will be easy. Right. See, 2,4,6 tribromophenol. Okay. So then it is a white precipitate. What is it, Nana? White precipitate. Okay. White precipitate. Please remember, when it is treated with a bromine in the presence of carbon disulfide at 0 degree centigrade, it gives ortho-bromophenol and para-bromophenol. And when it is treated with the bromine water, what does it give? It gives 2,4,6 tribromophenol, a white precipitate of this. Okay. So this is halogenation, and in particular, we can call it as bromination, because we are substituting the hydrogen with bromine. Okay, bromination, right? So now let us move to the other reactions of this. Okay, and then now see, now I'm going to discuss a very very important reaction. I can say Reimer-Tyman reaction. What is it? Reimer-Tyman reaction, another name reaction, children. Reimer-Tyman reaction. So what is this Reimer-Tyman reaction? Let us see. So a very very important reaction, a name reaction, which is frequently asked for your 2 marks, right? And also for 8 marks, see, you will get 4 name reactions, 4 to 8, right? So you just write the statement and the reaction, then it's enough. So Reimer-Tyman reaction. See, what is this Reimer-Tyman reaction? Let me tell you. So phenol, when treated with chloroform, okay, phenol when treated with chloroform, so in the presence of a base, what is that base? NaOH. NaOH is a base, alkali, right? We can call it as alkali also, right? What does it give? It give ortho hydroxy benzaldehyde. What does it give? Ortho hydroxy benzaldehyde. See, this is a benzaldehyde, nana, and this is ortho position to benzaldehyde, right? So ortho hydroxy benzaldehyde and sodium chloride and water. Sodium chloride and water. So this reaction is called as Reimer-Tyman reaction. So phenol reacts with the chloroform in the presence of a base, that is NaOH, right, and forms ortho hydroxy benzaldehyde. I'll write the name here. So what is the name of this compound? Ortho hydroxy benzaldehyde. And then the common name of this is salicylaldehyde. Okay, salicylaldehyde, salicylaldehyde. Okay, salicylaldehyde. So this is our chloroform, CHCl3, right? So which is used to preserve the animals, right? Chloroform, previously it was used as a local anesthetic. Phenol plus chloroform plus NaOH gives rise to the ortho hydroxy benzaldehyde, which is called as salicylaldehyde. What is it? Salicylaldehyde. So this is called as Reimer-Tyman reaction. What reaction? Reimer-Tyman reaction. So the name is somewhat peculiar, but the reaction is very simple. Just remember like this. So phenol, when treated with chloroform in the presence of sodium hydroxide, it gives ortho hydroxy benzaldehyde or salicylaldehyde. So this reaction is called as Reimer-Tyman reaction. Okay. See, now tell me regarding the objective point, what is the question you will get from this? So phenol, when treated with carbon tetrachloride instead of this chloroform, you will get carbon tetrachloride instead of chloroform. So let us see what we get. So we get, see here, we can take instead of NaOH, say we can go for KOH also, that is potassium hydroxide. So KOH plus carbon tetrachloride, okay, and when you heat this, so you will get salicylic acid instead of salicylaldehyde. Okay, so what do you get? Salicylic acid, ortho hydroxy benzoic acid. What is it? Ortho hydroxy benzoic acid. So please remember, ortho hydroxy benzoic acid. Okay, what is the common name of this, nana? The common name of this is salicylic acid. Salicylic acid. So please remember, so write a note here. So please put a note and remember. So when phenol is treated with carbon tetrachloride, so what is it? Carbon tetrachloride. So what do you get when it is treated with carbon tetrachloride? instead of salicylaldehyde, you will get salicylic acid. So phenol. Okay. See, I am writing in each and every equation the names of the reactants, Nana. Why? Because such that you may not be confused, or you should feel it very easy. Okay. So this is the Riemann-Tiemann reaction. So please listen to me, and then please write all the name reactions, such that every day, if you see that, you will be very thorough about the name reactions. And then coming to the next reaction, see, the next reaction is a Kolb's reaction. Okay, Kolb's reaction. Then what is this Kolb's reaction? Let us see. K-O-L-B-E, first V-S. Kolb's reaction. It is the name of the scientist. What is this reaction? So phenol, when treated with NaOH, that is a base, sodium hydroxide, what does it give? When it is treated with NaOH, obviously, what does it give? It gives sodium phenoxide. What does it give? Sodium phenoxide. And then when it is treated with carbon dioxide, so when it is treated with carbon dioxide, okay, so what does it give? It gives, see, the carboxylate ion is substituted at the ortho position like this. So O minus Na plus, right? This is a CO, O minus, and then H like this. Now, on hydrolysis, acid hydrolysis, what do you get? So you will get, what does you get? You will get again our salicylic acid. What does you get? Salicylic acid. This one. So ortho hydroxy benzoic acid. Ortho hydroxy benzoic acid. Nothing but salicylic acid. So this reaction is called as Kolb's reaction. See, you may skip this. You can directly write like this. See, phenol, when treated with a base, it gives sodium phenoxide. So which, on treatment with carbon dioxide, gives ortho hydroxy benzoic acid. See, here you can say that, it can undergo hydrolysis. Like, you can write like this. So let me write the names of these compounds. So phenol, when reacts with NaOH, a base, forms sodium phenoxide. Okay. And when it is treated with carbon dioxide and on acid hydrolysis, you get ortho hydroxy benzoic acid. See, what is the name of this? Salicylic acid. Salicylic acid. And this reaction is called as Kolb's reaction. What reaction, ma? Kolb's reaction. Right? See, here you have to remember one thing. If KOH is used here, if KOH is used, potassium hydroxide is used, okay, so you will get para-hydroxybenzoic acid. Remember, what do you get? So I'll go for another color such that you can easily identify the difference. Para-hydroxybenzoic acid is obtained. Okay, so please remember, is formed. You can write any of the words. Okay, both of them will have the same meaning, obtained or formed. Okay, so if KOH is used, write note and then remember this point. If KOH is used, para-hydroxy benzoic acid is formed. Okay, so then now let us move to the next reaction. Okay, so the next one is reduction of phenol. Reduction of phenol. See, what is reduction? Addition of hydrogens, right? Or removal of oxygens, right? Reduction of phenol. So phenol on reduction. Phenol on reduction. In the presence of zinc dust, okay? When heated with zinc dust. See, this oxygen will be eliminated in the form of zinc oxide. What do you get? You will get our benzene. What do you get? Benzene. Right? Very simple. See, what did I tell you? Reduction means addition of hydrogens. See, I have removed this oxygen. Okay. And then the hydrogen is replaced here. So this is a C6H6. So I will write the formula. You can understand it better. C6H5OH, isn't it? Now, what is this? C6H6. So reduction, addition of hydrogen, addition of hydrogen. Okay. So I will write the name also. What is this? The phenol. And this is benzene. What is this? Benzene. Okay. So I hope you have understood this, Nana. So now let us go for the oxidation. So I will write the reaction here itself. See, there is no need to go for a fresh page. What is oxidation? Addition of oxygen is called as oxidation. Removal of hydrogen or addition of oxygen is called as oxidation. So phenol, when treated with phenol on oxidation or when treated with chromic acid, Na2Cr2O7 plus H2SO4. Okay, right? So what do you get? So this is nothing but chromic acid, H2CrO4, chromic acid. What does it undergo? It undergoes oxidation. It undergoes oxidation. And it forms benzoquinone. What does it form? Benzoquinone. Okay. It is taking as a default, don't worry. So this is a benzoquinone. So let me write the name of this. Okay, ma'am. Benzoquinone. So this is our oxidation. So phenol, when oxidized with chromic acid, okay, it produces benzoquinone. What is this benzoquinone? If you observe carefully, you can see two ketonic groups here, double bond O. So isn't it? Yes. So it is a conjugate diketone. Conjugate diketone. Okay, Nana? Conjugate diketone. Okay, so this is about the reduction of the phenol and then oxidation of phenol, right? So this is reduction and this one is oxidation. Now let us move to the next property of phenols. Okay, so then what is this property? Let us see. See, this is another name reaction which is called as a freeze rearrangement. See, the name itself is telling that rearrangement means the atoms are rearranged. Okay. Freeze rearrangement. So what is freeze rearrangement? Now let us see. So this is our phenol, isn't it? Yes. When it is treated with acetic anhydride, a derivative of carboxylic acid. Acetic anhydride, right? Acetic anhydride. So what does it give? In the presence of anhydrous AlCl3, anhydrous AlCl3, so it gives acetophenone. As discussed earlier, we have seen in the formation of ester, that is the Scharton-Bowman reaction just now, isn't it? So it gives acetophenone, and then this, when heated with AlCl3, undergoes rearrangement. I'll go for another color. What is it? Rearrangement. It undergoes rearrangement. So the atoms are rearranged. And then what compounds you get? You will get two compounds. See the specialty of this reaction, children. So one is the orthohydroxyacetophenone, and then the other one is, yes, you are correct, it is para hydroxyacetophenone. So this is our para hydroxy acetophenol. Okay, COCH3. So shall I write again that one? Yes, I will write. Don't worry. So what is this? COCH3. So ortho hydroxy acetophenol. And then para hydroxy acetophenol. Simply rearrangement. Okay, see the acetyl group was rearranged at ortho position and para position. So this is ortho hydroxy acetophenol and this one is para hydroxy acetophenol. Para hydroxy acetophenol. Okay. So this is called as a Friis rearrangement. So Friis is the name of the scientist and this is a rearrangement. Phenol. And what is this? Acetic anhydride. Anhydride. When you take, see I will show you how this anhydride is obtained. Okay, in another slide. So this is Friis rearrangement. Phenol, when treated with acetic anhydride, in the presence of anhydrous aluminium chloride, is acetophenol and on treatment with AlCl3, rearrangement takes place at the ortho and para positions. So this is called as a Friis rearrangement. What is it? Friis rearrangement. Okay, so now I promised you that I will show how this acetic anhydride is obtained. Okay, so it's very simple. So just 1 minute. Yes. So let me write how acetic anhydride is obtained here, children. Just 1 minute. So give me 1 minute of time. So let me open my whiteboard and then, yes. Okay, I think now it's okay, children, right? So I have to check out carefully on the screen and also on my digital pad. Yes. So then this is acetic acid, CH3. See, sorry for the delay, CH3COOH. And this is also CH3COOH. So nothing but two molecules of acetic acid. So one water molecule is eliminated from both of this. So now you get this acetic anhydride, CH3C double bond O, O, CH3, okay, C double bond O. So what is this acetic anhydride? So my whiteboard didn't trouble me. So this is the first time. So just give me some time. So then let us recall what we have learned today. So that's a freeze rearrangement, the previous reaction, what we have learned. So when phenol is treated with acetic anhydride in the presence of anhydrous aluminium trichloride, so it gives ortho-hydroxyacetophenone and para-hydroxyacetophenone. So then now let us see the formation of acetic anhydride. Okay, so then CH3, C double bond O, CH3, C double bond O, plus H2. So this is acetic anhydride. What is this? Acetic anhydride. Okay, right. So now let us move to the other reactions of these phenols. See, this is the diazonium coupling reaction. What is it? Diazonium coupling reaction. See, what is this diazonium coupling? I will tell you. Right. See, please put the subheading diazonium coupling. Coupling means what? Fusion of two nuclei. So diazonium coupling reaction. What is this diazonium coupling reaction? Let us see. So phenol, when heated with benzene diazonium chloride, what is this? So this is our benzene diazonium chloride. This is benzene, this is diazonium chloride when treated with phenol. So this is the compound which we are discussing, right? So what is this? This is our phenol. In the presence of, when it is treated with benzene diazonium chloride, what does it give? It gives para-hydroxyazobenzene. What does it give? It gives para-hydroxyazobenzene. Okay, like this. Right, two benzene nuclei, and you unite them with the diazonium group. Okay, right? Yes. So this is our OH. Okay. So what is eliminated? HCl is eliminated. So what is this? This is para hydroxy azobenzene, which is a orange colored dye. Okay, para hydroxy azobenzene. Para-hydroxy-azobenzene, so which is an orange color dye. Orange color dye. Okay. So this is our benzene diazonium chloride. Benzene diazonium chloride. Benzene diazonium chloride when treated with, or when heated with phenol. So you will get para. So this is the para position, isn't it? Para hydroxy azobenzene. Azo. Nitrogen bonding is there, then we call it as azo. Azo. So para hydroxy azobenzene. So this is called as a coupling reaction. What reaction is it? Coupling reaction. So now let us move to the last reaction of phenols. And then today I think I can start the ethers also for you, and then if time is sufficient, then I can explain you up to the introduction of ethers. And in my next session, I am going to close this compounds which contain the OH group. See, this is the most important reaction, children. So thallene reaction. What reaction is it? Thallene reaction. See, what is this thallene reaction? I will tell you. So phenol, when heated with phthalic anhydride, what is it? This is our phenol. Okay, so what is it? Phenol, when heated with phthalic anhydride, phthalic anhydride, So this is our right C anhydride. Just now I have shown you. This is C double bond O. Okay. Now what is eliminated? See, let me show you. The hydrogen will be there. Here also hydrogen will be there, isn't it? That hydrogen means two hydrogens from here and here and one oxygen. So what will be eliminated? I will specify this like this H and this is O. So let me eliminate this with a dotted line. Let me show you what are eliminated. H2O. Okay. So you can write directly also. See, for the sake of such that you can understand it in a very easy manner, I'm showing this. So this is our concentrated sulfuric acid. So phenol, when heated with the phthalic anhydride, what is it losing? It is losing a water molecule. And what does it form? So it forms phenolphthalein. What does it form? Phenolphthalein. What is this phenolphthalein? See here, see the beauty of the reaction. So phenol and then phthalic anhydride, both of them are combining to form the phenolphthalein. We call it as phenolphthalein, which is an indicator. What is it? Indicator. In your first year in acids and bases, you have learned about acid-base indicators, isn't it? So phenolphthalein. So carbon, okay, unite them by a carbon atom here and then C, okay. So then this is also another C, double bond O, okay. So this is O, O. And now this is our benzene, right? So this is phenolphthalein. What is this? Phenolphthalein. Phenolphthalein. Okay, right. Yes. Right? Phenolphthalein. Phenolphthalein is a indicator. Okay. So then this is about phenols, children. Okay. So let me explain you the properties of phenols once again. So phenols, we started with the Scotten-Baumann reaction. What is the reaction which we have learned in the beginning of the class? That is the Scotten-Baumann reaction. Okay. So what is Scotten-Baumann reaction? So it is a esterification we have learned, right? So let us recall one by one. This is a Scotten-Baumann reaction. Phenol, when treated with acetic acid, gives phenyl acetate, which is an ester. And this reaction is called as Scotten-Baumann reaction. And this is also called as esterification. So what is it? Esterification. Okay. So then phenol again reacts with the derivatives of carboxylic acids. What is it? Derivatives of carboxylic acids. And then it also forms esters. So the reaction we have seen with the acetyl chloride, here also an ester is produced. So this is also an ester. And this is the first reaction which we have discussed. And then we move to the electrophilic aromatic substitution reactions. See, as this is a substitution reaction, why? Because the atoms are replaced by another atom or another group. And then this is electrophilic substitution because an electrophile is being substituted here. And then the OH group, which is present in phenol, is an ortho para directing group. Okay, because it releases electrons at the ortho para positions, means the ortho para positions are dense with electrons or rich with electrons. Hence, an electrophile will attack at that positions because an electrophile is electron deficient species, electron attracting species, or electron seeking species. The first one is nitration. Phenol, when treated with dilute nitric acid, gives orthonitrophenol and then paranitrophenol. See, orthonitrophenol has a intramolecular hydrogen bonding. Okay, so this intramolecular hydrogen bonding, and then paranitrophenol is having intermolecular hydrogen bonding. Orthonitrophenol is a steam volatile, whereas paranitrophenol is a less steam volatile because it has intramolecular hydrogen bonding and Paranitrophenol has intermolecular hydrogen bonding. Okay, so then I have shown you the nitration, that is when treated with concentrated nitric acid, what is the product you will get here? See, when it is heated with concentrated nitric acid, okay, so you will get 2,4,6 trinitrophenol. So 2,4,6 trinitrophenol is called as a picric acid. See, this is a action with concentrated nitric acid. I will write here separately such that it is easy for you. Action with concentrated nitric acid. Okay, so then you'll get 2,4,6 trinitrophenol, which is called as picric acid. And this is the old method, children. And then the new method is treated with sulfuric acid first, and then you'll get disulfonic acid along with phenol. Then when it is heated with concentrated nitric acid, you'll get our picric acid, that is 2,4,6 trinitrophenol. See, this is the second carbon. So 2, fourth carbon, 4, sixth carbon, 6, 2,4,6 trinitro, three times, nitro group is repeating, trinitrophenol. Okay, now, see, then I explained you about the halogenation, right? Here we have discussed about the bromination, isn't it? So phenols, when treated with bromine in the presence of carbon disulfide, at 0 degrees centigrade, gives orthobromophenol and parabromophenol. When it is heated with bromine water at 0 to 5 degrees centigrade, when it is treated with bromine water at 0 to 5 degrees centigrade, so we get 2,4,6 tribromophenol, a white precipitate of 2,4,6 tribromophenol is obtained. Okay, so then we have discussed about the Riemer-Tiemann reaction. So a very famous and important name reaction, children. What is Riemer-Tiemann reaction? So phenol, when treated with chloroform in the presence of a base NaOH, gives orthohydroxybenzaldehyde or salicylaldehyde. Okay, and this reaction is called as Riemer-Tiemann reaction. And then I have explained you the other one also, that is when you take carbon tetrachloride instead of this chloroform, what do you get? So if you take carbon tetrachloride, you will get salicylic acid. So this is nothing but carbon tetrachloride. Tetra means how many? 4. So 4 chlorines, tetrachloride. So that is the thing what you have to remember here. So when you take CCl4, you will get salicylic acid. If you take chloroform, what do you get? You will get salicylaldehyde. Okay. So then we entered into the Kolb's reaction. So phenol is treated with NaOH and gives sodium phenoxide, which on treatment with the carbon dioxide and on hydrolysis gives orthohydroxybenzoic acid. So here also, I told you to remember an important thing here. If KOH is used, you will get parahydroxybenzoic acid. See, these are all the applications, children. So the concept is same from years. The concept will be always same, but just the application part will be different. See, the pattern, how they ask questions is different. See, this is reduction of phenol. Phenol, when treated with zinc dust and on heating, gives benzene, and then zinc oxide is eliminated. The oxygen is eliminated in the form of ZnO. So phenol on distillation with zinc dust gives benzene. And then coming to the next one, that is oxidation. Phenol on oxidation with chromic acid, that is when treated with sodium dichromate and sulfuric acid, gives benzoquinone. And I told you that it is a conjugate diketone, di, two times repeating, ketone group. So conjugate diketone. So then we moved to the Friis rearrangement. What is it? Friis rearrangement. Rearrangement means nothing but the arrangement, rearrangement of atoms, shuffling the atoms, right? Groups in the same compound. phenol when treated with acetic anhydride in the presence of anhydrous AlCl3 gives acetophenol. This rearranges into two compounds, orthohydroxyacetophenone and parahydroxyacetophenone. Okay, so this is a three rearrangement. And then I explained you about the diazonium coupling, isn't it? Yes. So this is a coupling. Coupling chloride is coupled, means fused with the phenol. And what does it form? It forms the parahydroxy azobenzene, which is an orange color dye. See, both of the nuclei are fused here, right? So that is a fusion, coupling. Okay, parahydroxy azobenzene. So then we entered into the next reaction. What is it? It's the thallium reaction. What is it, Nana? Thallium reaction. So what is this thallium reaction? So this is our phenol. Now I will write here. So this is our phthalic anhydride. Okay, be silent here. Phthalic anhydride. Anhydride without water molecule. Just now I have shown you acetic anhydride, isn't it? Like this is phthalic anhydride. And this is our phenol. So phenol, when heated with or when treated with, okay, so that is phthalic anhydride gives, what does it give? Phenolphthalein. What is this phenolphthalein? Phenolphthalein is an indicator. It is an indicator, acid-base indicator, right? Acid-base indicator. Okay, so then, so this is about the phenols and their properties. Okay, children, I hope you have understood this. So then let us move to the ethers, children. Okay. So then what are these ethers? Let me tell you. So just I will introduce that and we will move into the another session tomorrow. So this is our ethers, right? So ethers. What are ethers? ROR is a general representation of an ether. So let me introduce this to you. Okay. Right, so we are discussing about ethers. So these are the organic compounds which contains oxygen. So in our previous classes we have discussed about alcohols and phenols, isn't it? Now it's the time for ethers. Okay, then see, what is this R-OH? Alcohol, isn't it? What is this HOH? Water, right? So this is alcohol and this is water. Now when I replace this hydrogen, I'm adding an alkyl group to this. Okay. So what do you get? You will get an ether. You will get an ether like this. Right? Now, when I replace both the hydrogens here with two alkyl groups, how many alkyl groups? Two alkyl groups. Right? So what do you get? You will get an ether. ROR means they are the mono alkyl derivatives of alcohols. Okay, see, my like my vision is to tell you how they are obtained from alcohols and how they are called. I can say that how they are called mono alkyl derivatives of alcohols, mono alkyl derivatives of alcohol. Okay, Nana? Mono. Mono means one. Okay? Mono alkyl. One alkyl group is replaced, isn't it? Yes. Mono alkyl derivatives of alcohols. And then dialkyl derivatives of water. Dialkyl derivatives of water are called as ethers, are called as ethers. Okay, Nana? So this is the general formula, that is ROR. Okay, see, then coming to the functional group and all, let us see. See, the functional group is COR, like this. Okay, COC, COC, right? So, and this oxygen is called as ethereal oxygen. What oxygen? Ethereal oxygen. Okay, so the ethereal oxygen is linked with two alkyl groups. Okay, so this is our ether. Okay, and this is our water, right? Like this, see here. Okay, and then this is our ether again. Now what I'm going to show you is very simple. So by this, you might have understood. Yes, nothing but the hydrogen bonding, isn't it? See, this is ether. This is water. And this is again ether. Then what is the bond they have in between? That is the intermolecular hydrogen bonding. Intermolecular hydrogen bonding. Okay, intermolecular hydrogen bonding. See, hope you are all writing the running notes, Nana. I think there is no problem to write the notes because I'm writing very clearly. Okay, so they have intermolecular hydrogen bonding. So then coming to the next one, then classification of ethers. See, you can check out the previous class also. We will proceed in a systematic way. First, we will go with the introduction, and then we will deal with the classification, then come into the IUPAC nomenclature, and then isomerism, then preparations and properties, classification. Ethers are classified into two types. How many types? Two types. So ethers are of two types. What are they? They are simple ethers and mixed ethers. Simple ethers or mixed ethers. Then the simple ethers can be called as symmetric ethers. Symmetric. Okay. Symmetric. Mixed. Unsymmetric. Okay. Mixed ethers. What is it? Unsymmetric ethers. Unsymmetric ethers. Okay, Nana? Unsymmetrical ethers. Symmetrical ethers, unsymmetrical ethers. Okay? So, CH3, O, CH3, right? C2H5, O, C2H5. Right? So, then coming to the next one. So, what is it? So, so this is a dimethyl ether, right? Dimethyl ether. This is a diethyl ether. This is dimethyl ether. This is diethyl ether. When you observe carefully, see here, the oxygen is bonded with the two methyl groups. Here, with the two ethyl groups, isn't it? So, same groups. This is also same and this is also same. See, such type of ethers are called as simple ethers. What is it? Simple ethers. Simple ethers. Understood, Nana? Simple or symmetrical. When the ethereal oxygen is bonded with two similar alkyl groups, simple ethers, then unsymmetrical ethers. Let us see. So CH3O C2H5. Okay, then C2H5O C3H7. So this is a ethyl methyl ether according to the alphabetical order. E comes first, isn't it? So ethyl methyl ether, and this is methyl propyl ether. So this is a ethyl methyl ether. Ethyl propyl ether. Now, if you observe here, so this is the methyl group, one carbon, and this is ethyl group, two carbons. Here it is ethyl, two carbons, and it is propyl. How many carbons? Three carbons, isn't it? So So they are having different number of alkyl groups attached to the ethereal oxygen. So such type of ethers are called as, yes, mixed ethers, mixed, or unsymmetrical, means not same, unsymmetrical. Understood? I hope it is clear for you now. It's very simple, Nana, very easy. So they are classified into how many types? Two types. So simple ethers or symmetrical ethers. See, then what is the second type? See, the second type is, what is the second type? See, it is a mixed ether or unsymmetrical ether. Okay, so this is the classification of ethers. And then see, today I think I can teach you the nomenclature and I will wind off the class. So in my next class, I will deal with the remaining isomerism, preparation and properties. And then if possible, I will move into the next chapter, that is aldehydes and ketones in this. See, now let us see the nomenclature. According to the IUPAC nomenclature, ethers are called as, okay, see, according to the common system, they are called as alkyl ethers, common name. What is a common name? According to the common name, they are called as alkyl ethers, right? Now, means like this. See, dialkyl ethers. Now, IUPAC nomenclature, they are called as alkoxyalkanes. What is it? Alkoxyalkanes. Alkoxyalkane. I will tell you, right, how to write this. So this is our simple ether, that is the dimethyl ether, the common name. How many methyl groups? Two methyl groups. So dimethyl ether is the common name. According to the IUPAC nomenclature, alkoxyalkane is a methyl group with oxygen. What do you call them? If you combine this with a methyl group, so you will call it as the, oh, again, starting. So you will call it as dimethyl ether, isn't it the common name? Then if you club this with oxygen, you call it as methoxy. What is it? Methoxy methane. You have to combine one alkyl group with oxygen and you should call it as alkoxy. And then you should end the other one as methane. So methoxy methane. What is it? Methoxy methane. Right? So methoxy methane. Yeah. It's methoxy methane. Okay, Nana. So what is this? Methoxy methane. So then coming to the next one, C2H5OCH3. Right, so this is dimethyl ether and this is methoxy methane. Now see, this is ethyl methyl ether, ethyl methyl ether. Then IUPAC nomenclature, you have to club when two different alkyl groups are there, when two different alkyl groups are there, please remember, see, this is ethyl and this is methyl, ether two, meth one, then you should combine the shortest alkyl group with the oxygen. So what do you call it as? Methoxy, isn't it? Yes. And then you should call the other alkyl group as alkane. What is that? Methoxy ethane. Yes, simple. Methoxy ethane. We will work out other examples also, such that it will be easy for you, right? So C2H5OC3H7. Right? What is the common name, Nana? See, the common name is ethyl propyl ether. Ethyl propyl ether. Okay? So, E, 2, propyl, 3. Then, what is IUPAC nomenclature? See, the IUPAC nomenclature, so the rule is shortest should be clubbed with oxygen. The longest should be called as alkane. See, what do you call it as? So, you will call it as ethoxy propane. Ethoxy propane. Okay, Nana. So now I think it's clear for you. Ethoxypropane. See, ethoxypropane. So I will write some more examples. C2H5O. Okay. Then CH3 taken twice. Yes. By this time, many of you have identified this. See, what is this? This is isopropyl ethyl ether, isn't it? Then how to write the IUPAC name for this? This is 2-ethoxypropane. What is it? 2-ethoxypropane. See, how to write this? It's a structural formula. CH3, CH2O, okay? CH3. Right? Yes. Now, see, this is a 2-ethoxy. Understood, Nana? So this is 1, 2, 3, propane. Okay? Then, this is the second carbon. So, 2-ethoxy. This is a 2-ethoxypropane. Understood? 2-ethoxypropane. I think it is clear for you now, children. So, now let me show you a few more examples. Right? I will take another example like this. So C6H5. Now I have taken an aromatic ether. Okay. C6H5OCH3. So this is a methylphenyl ether, isn't it? Now how to write the IUPAC name for this? See, this is a methoxybenzene. Methoxybenzene. And the common name of this is anisole. 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 So let me write the structural formula of this. So this is OCH3. Understood, Nana? So this is a methylphenyl ether. Methylphenyl ether. That is methoxybenzene. Anisole. Okay, so now let us write few more examples for this. C6H5. No, this is a C. Okay, I will write again, don't worry. Okay, so C6H5O C6H5. See, two phenyl groups are there. The phenoxybenzene. Okay, so what is this? Phenoxybenzene. Phenoxybenzene. Like this. Phenoxybenzene. Now I will give you a very interesting example, children. So hope I'm clear with from my side, children. So, and you are all writing notes. See, frequently I'm repeating this. Why? Because such that you should not miss your classes. Okay, so please write down the notes and learn every day, because you can assimilate knowledge every day, right? Not for a single day. So nothing can be done in a single day, right? So then see here. So this is 1,1, okay, 1,1 dimethoxy. Understood? 1,1 dimethoxy ethane. Okay, what is it? 1,1 dimethoxyethane. Okay, Nana? 1,1 dimethoxyethane. So this is the IUPAC nomenclature of ethers, right? So in my next session, I will deal with the isomerism and properties, preparations, and then properties of ethers, children. So until then, you just go through the classes, watch our YouTube channel, right? So please write down the notes. And then I thank each and everyone for giving me this wonderful opportunity to be a part of this webinar team, and also my privilege to be a chemistry teacher for you, children. So thank you, Shailja ma'am.
Thank you, madam. It was interesting indeed. Thank you. Today, today even I have listened to your class, keeping the textbook aside. And dear children, it was a wonderful session. Madam, whatever madam has told, if you keep your textbook and your running notes with you and you prepare your own notes, madam has lucidly explained everything. Everything was clear. Put your textbook next to you and refer to the madam notes, and you can prepare a running notes of yourself and practice more. For any clarifications or any doubts, you can revisit and you can post your queries in the comment section. And
thank you.
Whatever madam says, if you further feel any doubts, you can ask your respective teachers. Thank you, madam. Thank you for a wonderful session.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you. Thank you for the
opportunity. The next class, you will be referring about, referring to?
Ma'am, in my next session, I'm going to deal with the isomerism of ethers.
Isomerism
then,
of ethers.
Yes, sir. The preparations of ethers and properties of ethers, ma'am. If possible, I can continue the aldehydes and ketones, ma'am. I will start aldehydes and ketones. It is a very biggest topic in organic chemistry.
Yes, yes.
Yeah, it includes many name reactions, ma'am. That's what I'm telling to the students, to write all the name reactions and to learn them every day, to recall the name reactions every day.
And today, whatever you have said, my favorite reaction was Riemann-Thiemann reaction.
Yes, ma'am.
That is very important also.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. Every time it is asked for 2 marks.
Okay, 2 marks.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Thank you, madam. Thank you, children.
Thank you, ma'am.
We'll meet you in the next session.
Yeah, thank you, ma'am. Thank you so much.
Till then, stay home, stay safe.
Yeah.